Hey there, and welcome to Tempo Control. Let's get a musical grip together on games in time. My name is Peter Spezia, and it's time to count down the top 10 best songs from a specific video game soundtrack. Also coming up today on the show, final predictions for PlayStation VR release date and price, Lionhead Studios expected to close, The Division shows that online games have a long way to go, and we rank the best Pokemon generations. Now remember, before we talk game tunes and game news, video game music is art, and art is subjective. We have a team that crafts our list in an attempt to be a definitive list for a specific title, and you're certainly welcome to your opinion on that list, so leave a comment below, let us know on Twitter at Tempo Control, or send us an email at tempocontrolshow@gmail.com. We are brought to you by RhymesWithAsia.com. Before we recap the week of March 6th, 2016, in this fourth episode of the podcast, let's introduce this week's game. You are a brand new Pokemon trainer from Nuvematown in the Unova region. After you and your childhood friends Charon and Bianca receive your starter Pokemon from Professor Juniper, your journey begins. While you capture, battle, and raise new Pokemon, you encounter the nefarious Team Plasma and their leader, a boy by the name of N. Team Plasma claims that their goal is to separate Pokemon from people, since they believe that humans are only hindrances to the lives and interests of Pokemon. But is that all there is to it? What does the legendary Pokemon of the land have to do with N's motives? Ultimately, can you become Pokemon League champion? The game is Pokemon Black and White, and its soundtrack is in need of a proper countdown. So let's see what we have this time. In this piece, listen to the accents that the flutes provide in this happy tune. This was the first time that we saw a sprawling city like this in the Pokemon games, and this track is surely befitting of that metropolis. At number 10, it's Castellia City. Welcome back to Tempo Control. PlayStation has an upcoming panel at the Game Developers Conference, also known as GDC. That's this Tuesday, March 15th at 5 p.m. Eastern Time. The focus is PlayStation VR, because after the press conference, the media that they've invited are going to be playing different demos and trying out the device. So it's pretty much expected that the release date and price of PlayStation VR is about to be revealed. After all, Sony's been giving the media kind of an in-depth look, and they're really kind of ramping up that coverage. They gave Polygon an in-depth historical look at how PlayStation VR was created, just giving them all sorts of access. So if that's not a sign that they're ready to talk more openly about this device, I'm not sure what is. It is time, though, to have that date and price revealed. After all, Sony's top competitors in this space with Oculus Rift and HTC Vive, they've both revealed the release months and the prices, with Rift at $599 and Vive at $799 respectively. It's interesting to see Sony signaling on this though, because they're saying that it's a new gaming platform, not something that is tied to PlayStation 4 as a peripheral, and it looks like they're sacrificing high-end quality for market reach instead. After all, from that aforementioned Polygon article, Sony Computer Entertainment Vice President Masayasu Ito says, "If you just talk about the high-end quality, yes, I would admit that Oculus may have better VR. However, it requires a very expensive and very fast PC. The biggest advantage for Sony is our headset works with PS4. It's more for everyday use, so it has to be easy to use and it has to be affordable. This is not for the person who uses a high-end PC. It's for the mass market." You combine this with GameStop CEO Paul Raines saying in an interview on Fox Business that GameStop will launch the Sony product this fall, and we may have our answers already with release timing and price. Though it's important to note that Sony said that this was just speculation, though they declined to comment if the product PlayStation VR was staying in the first half of 2016. So what's my final prediction on the release date and price of PlayStation VR? Well, I've already made several video game predictions at the beginning of this year that you can go read on rhymeswithasia.com, and one of those was about PlayStation VR. Said it would launch in June alongside No Man's Sky as a supported title there, and it would be $399. So I know, $299 may be the best price for consumers, but Sony has to make some money on this thing. And if $299 is around the same price as a PlayStation 4, if this is a new gaming platform, plus we've already seen the prices of the competitor models, VR may be more of an expensive venture than we at first thought. So that's it. I'm sticking to my guns. June 21st, alongside No Man's Sky, $399. I hope I'm right. Maybe on the price side I will be, but probably not on the timing. What are your guesses? Let us know in the comments below. In this piece, listen to the variation on the main Pokemon theme and how it's played even more triumphantly. The gym leader is down to his last Pokemon, and you're about to get that badge. At number 9, its victory is right before your eyes.
Gentlemen, welcome one and all to the exhibition match of the century. The crowd is roaring in anticipation, so let's get right down into it. In the red corner, he's always composed and rarely beaten, it's Peter Spezia. And now in the white corner stands a new face for this league, but a familiar foe to many. It's Matthew Zawadniak.
I'm glad we finally had time to get around to this. I've wanted to challenge you for a while.
Careful, Pete. I won't hold back just because we're friends.
I wouldn't expect you to.
Just a reminder, folks, that today's best of three battle is an official Unova Pokemon League sanctioned event. Sponsored by Bouffalant Burgers. Burgers so wild, you'll charge their doors to get some more.
Remember to put on a show when you lose, okay?
Hey now, that's no advice to give to yourself. Gotta think positive.
Oh, I'm gonna enjoy this. Go, Golurk!
I choose you, Crocodile!
And the first round has begun. It looks like Matt might find himself at a disadvantage, throwing a ghost type out to greet Peter's dark type Pokemon.
So what's it gonna be? Switching out?
Don't you worry, I came prepared. Golurk, use Ice Beam.
Crocodile, go underground and avoid it.
And the fireworks have started! Golurk attempted what could have been a fatal Ice Beam, but was too slow to hit Crocodile. Oh, look who has now used Dig to burrow its way underground! And here it comes back to the surface! Oh, and it's a direct hit!
Hang in there, Golurk! Hit him with a hammer arm!
Oh, and Peter's celebration might have been a bit early as Crocodile suffers a super effective fighting-type move! Is he down for the count? No! He's back up!
You can do it! Use Crunch!
Avoid it and give him another hammer arm!
Both Pokemon are preparing to attack at the same time, but Golurk is too slow! Crocodile's jaws close in a devastating Crunch attack! Golurk is down! Round one goes to Peter and Crocodile!
Yeah! I knew you could do it! Good job!
You put up a good fight, buddy. Return!
Both trainers are now considering which Pokemon to throw out next. And it seems decisions have been made. Peter has thrown out the Ghost Fire type Pokemon Chandelure, and Matt has thrown out the Fire Fighting type Pokemon Emboar. It looks like this battle's about to heat up, folks. Much like our sponsor, Darmanitan Flakes, the world's first spicy breakfast cereal.
All right, Chandelure, use Psychic.
Emboar, use Protect.
That'll only work once. Use Psychic again.
Not so fast. We've got another trick up our sleeves.
What's this? For a fighting-type Pokemon that's staring down the barrel of a psychic-type attack, that Emboar is looking rather confident. Wait, what's this? Whoa, it's holding a Quick Claw.
It's our turn first. Emboar, use Swagger.
Oh no, Chandelure is confused.
What? No. Come on, Chandelure, you can do it! Use Psychic!
Chandelure has hurt itself in its confusion! Things might be turning around for Matt in round two!
Hang in there, Chandelure! Use Rest!
Chandelure still can't seem to get a handle on this situation! Oof, it's hurt itself once more! Is this the end?
It sure is! Alright, Emboar, give it a Stone Edge!
And there it is! Round two is ended by a devastating Stone Edge, and Chandelure goes down! The round goes to Matt and Emboar!
Even playing field now, Pete. Good job, Emboar. Come on back.
You did your best. But we gotta admit, that was a pretty good strategy.
You know, the next round decides everything. Why don't you save yourself the embarrassment and give up now?
Not happening. Let's do this! Zebstrika!
As you wish. Go, Garbodor!
Really? A Garbodor?
Yeah, what's wrong with Garbodor?
You just threw a literal pile of garbage into the ring.
Peter, words hurt, you know.
What's this, folks? The combatants seem to have been having some sort of discussion. But it appears round three is about to begin. Peter has thrown out the electric-type Pokemon Zebstrika, and Matt has thrown out the poison-type Garbodor. Neither side seemed to have the type advantage this time, so let's see how this plays out.
Zebstrika, let's start with the rain dance.
Uh-oh, grab an umbrella, folks. It's starting to pour.
Garbodor, throw a sludge bomb.
Zebstrika finds itself covered in sludge. Disgusting. Oh, but it seems to be gearing up for another attack.
You know what to do, Zebstrika. Let's hit it with a thunder.
Oh.
Wow, what an amazing hit! Garbodor is just hanging on by the skin of its teeth! This might be the end, folks.
I didn't want to do this, but it looks like we don't have a choice. Garbodor, self-destruct!
Hold on, what? We tied? That's a thing?
I just want to make sure that you're aware I have no regrets.
In this piece, listen to how the tempo changes over the course of the track, driven by that heavy bass. While you're keeping your fingers crossed, waiting for that last Pokeball shake to lock in, you may feel your heartbeat changing with the music. At number 8, its legendary Pokémon battle. Welcome back to Tempo Control. Sad news coming from Microsoft this past week announcing that Fable Legends development will be ceased and that they are talking to employees at Lionhead Studios for a possible closing of that legendary studio. Now, Lionhead has given people many great memories with the Fable series, but you know, that franchise really hasn't been the same since After 3. Of course, Lionhead is most famously associated with Peter Molyneux, but he left the studio in 2012 after the completion of Fable the Journey. Yeah, you remember Fable the Journey, that Kinect game that didn't do too well? Fable Legends was first revealed in August 2013, and we've seen it at a lot of industry events since then. It's really surprising that it's not out yet. The overall idea of the game was pretty simple. You and your friends play as four heroes, and you battle the evil imagination of the villain, who another player can also control. The problem was this was developed at a time when smart glass was a big initiative for Microsoft, that second screen tablet experience that you can have asymmetrical play on. So it kind of went through some phases when smart glass didn't really pan out like Microsoft wanted it to. There was like a free-to-play model announced for Fable Legends, it went into some sort of beta mode, but we haven't seen the actual game release. Which is odd, considering it was still part of the greatest games lineup in Xbox history, as late as E3 2015. Though there's an interesting twist to this story, Sony, of all companies, announced this week that they're having a job fair available to those Lionhead employees. So what may be Microsoft's scraps just may be Sony's gain in this case. But the sad news didn't stop there, as Microsoft also announced the closure of Press Play Studios from Denmark, and they were the developers of Max and the Curse of Brotherhood and Kalimba. Of course, Microsoft had to do some PR spin about the European game developers that they still had. They have, you know, Rare, Remedy, among others. But it's always sad when people lose their jobs, but ultimately, at the end of the day, when it comes to Lionhead, they didn't deliver their game, and that's a problem. I hope that those with a passion for the Lionhead of old can still hold on to those memories that the old Fable games gave them, because, as sad as it is to say, I don't think it's the same company as it once was. Sad to see you go, Lionhead. Never good that people lose their jobs, but when you don't deliver on a game, it tends to happen. In this piece, listen to the castanet-like snare sound that perfectly balances that soaring melody. You know, some people say that this is one of the best root songs in all of the Pokemon games, and I'm inclined to agree with them. At number 7, it's Route 10. Welcome back. So what games have I been playing this week? Well, I put about a dozen hours into The Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess HD, and I am loving it so far. Whether it's the little touches on the map, like little notifications on where side quests are, or even how many Po Souls are available in each area, these kind of touches are great, but the biggest revolution of that game is, since I'm playing on a Wii U Pro controller, and I know not the gamepad, so I'm not doing the hot, you know, swapping of the items on the fly, but the right analog stick for camera control is a game changer. No longer am I just constantly, you know, centering myself behind Link like I used to when I was playing on the Wii and the GameCube version. So I'm really enjoying that so far. I'm at Arbiter's Grounds just at the start of it, so about to play one of the best dungeons in Zelda history, I think, and I'm just really having a great time with it. Something that's on my gaming docket coming up is the new Hitman game, which I have the full version of thanks to some complications on Amazon, so there's episode 1 to play. Looking forward to trying that. It seems really interesting despite the terrible, you know, pricing product model that Square Enix decided to put out for that. And then also The Division is coming in the mail as we have the Gamefly service, and Gamefly actually delivered, you know, sending out a game in its first release week, so excited to try The Division as well. but I really got to get back to Fire Emblem Fates, though I'm traveling next week for work, and that's probably when I'm going to catch up on that, you know, on the plane. Now, video game composers don't get nearly the amount of credit that they do, and that's something we'd like to change here at Tempo Control. The lead composer on Pokémon Black and White is Shota Kageyama, born on August 26, 1982. While he was the lead on Black and White, he's been with the music composition of the mainline series of Pokémon games all the way from HeartGold SoulSilver to Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire. In 2014, Kageyama announced that he was leaving Game Freak on amicable terms to form his own company, Spica Musica. Junichi Masuda, born on January 12, 1968. Not only is he one of the founding members of Game Freak, but he's a director of the Pokémon games and one of the main composers as well. Fans of the Pokémon games may recognize Masuda's name the most. He's one of the more forward-facing with the fans. He interacts with them, he blogs, he tweets, he goes on Japanese TV, and he even reveals behind-the-scenes secrets for the Pokémon games, such as the self-titled Masuda Method, which is a way for players to increase their chances of obtaining shiny Pokémon. Masuda has composed for every main Pokémon game. He was even the sole composer for Pokémon Red and Blue. But in Black and White, he primarily composed battle themes. Other composers for Pokémon Black and White include Go Ichinose, Hitomi Sato, Morikazu Aoki, Minako Adachi, and Satoshi Nohara. Thank you to all of these composers for creating one of the best soundtracks in all of the Pokémon games. In this piece, listen to the rhythm that drives the main beat of this track. You could make the case for this being the best villain grunt battle theme of the entire series. At number 6, it's Team Plasma Battle. Welcome back to Tempo Control. We first saw Tom Clancy's The Division at the end of the Ubisoft press conference at E3 2013. Just think about that for a second, because now it's finally out, trying to take the place of Destiny as the shooter in a persistent world that players will flock to. While Destiny developed into a solid product that even has a big expansion with The Taken King that totally delivered, The Division is still brand new, and even after two betas, its servers are struggling after launch. Players were having issues on launch day, no surprise, and the game servers had to be taken down for 2 hours in peak time on the second day after release. That's pretty crazy. Though it's interesting for these kind of persistent open worlds, how players are coming together to either adapt to or try to deconstruct the game based on the design choices of the game. Since missions are assigned at a desk and players have to come up to that desk to accept or refuse missions, you see players lining up, of all things, in a video game world. Now, since most games would have players clip through each other, but I guess not The Division, you're also seeing players trolling others by blocking the entrance or exits to these safe houses, just standing in the door right there. Or you have this kind of jumping jacks nightmare. Again, clipping through players would fix all of this. Now, the reviews are mostly positive for The Division, which is a good thing after it's been delayed for so long. They give praise to the graphics and the world building, though apparently the shooting mechanics and the AI is a little dull at this point, but you know, again, that can all be patched. That's the big thing though, patches are needed, and Ubisoft still has a lot to learn about making this kind of persistent open world game that they believe is their future as a company. And after Destiny brought in so much money as a big success for Activision, many AAA studios are kind of seeing that as the next big thing, kind of like what open world games used to be. It's really not my kind of game since I don't really like doing that kind of multiplayer with others, but I'm looking forward to trying a little bit solo when that game arrives soon for me, so I'll let you know what I think about it. In this piece, listen to the sense of how the stakes are really on the line in this battle piece. This is perhaps my favorite iteration of this kind of battle theme, and I hope it gets your toes tapping. At number 5, it's Gym Leader Battle. Welcome back. Now, it's nice to look back, but let's take a look at the old calendar and see what games are coming out this week that we'll have a chance to play. EA Sports UFC 2 is coming out March 15th to PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. Mario & Sonic at the Rio 2016 Olympic Games is coming out March 18th to Nintendo 3DS. And Pokken Tournament is coming out March 18th to Wii U. Which game are you looking forward to playing the most? Let us know in the comments below. In this piece, listen to how the main strings and organ just provide this relentless support that keeps moving the track forward. How fitting for the final area of the game, one last place for the hero to explore. At number 4, it's End's Castle. Welcome back to Tempo Control. Since this is a Pokemon episode for Pokken Tournament coming out this week, and Pokemon Black and White is one of my favorite soundtracks of all of them, really, it's time to count down what I think are the Pokemon generations in order of worst to first. Number 6, Generation 1, Red, Blue, and Yellow. Okay, look, Gen 1ers, I know it's trendy to look back on these games fondly, especially with the recent eShop releases of these games. It's great that everyone's going back to play them. But the fact of the matter is that these games are not as good as everyone remembers. I'm sorry, the Pokemon games have just gone through too many changes since that initial release almost 20 years ago. Yes, of course it was a solid foundation for these games. Of course it had to be good to make it such a big phenomenon, but people generally gloss over a lot of the flaws that Generation 1 had. You had things like rap spamming, where if you use an attack like rap and you were faster than your opponent, or heaven forbid a wild Pokemon was faster than you, they could just lock you down and spam that and beat you. It was ridiculous. You also had the OP unbeatable psychic type that really had no weaknesses at all. Ghost? Yeah, the only ghosts were part poison type, so psychic super effective. And then bug types and other types of these kinds of attacks, for some reason, didn't have the same type attack bonus at all, so psychic types were pretty much unbeatable. And what was up with the nonsense of you're frozen forever and it takes a whole turn to wake up from sleeping? You can't wake up and then do an attack like you could in later generations. No, it was ridiculous. So a good foundation for Generation 1, but not great games. Number 5, Generation 6, X and Y, and Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire. X and Y had a lot of great additions. It was the first 3D compatible game with 3D graphics and 3D models of the Pokemon. You had the player's search system. You had Super Training, which officially recognized EVs. You had Mega Evolution, and you had the introduction of the Fairy type. And then Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire expanded on that even more. You had the Delta episode, which expanded on the Ruby Sapphire Emerald story. You also had Latios and Latias riding you around and taking you to Mirage spots to catch legendary Pokemon. And the PokéNav Plus, to have those silhouettes on each route show you what Pokemon were there, that's the greatest motivation to have us really catch them all that I've seen in a long, long time. But let's face it, this game had significant performance and frame rate issues. You also had sky battles and horde encounters, which really weren't that great. The story was pretty terrible, actually. You know, too many rivals, Team Flare, just not good enough at all. Pokemon Ami can kind of be hit or miss, I guess. And then cosplay Pikachu, just terrible. Number 4, Generation 5, Black and White, Black and White 2. For a generation that was supposed to be a reboot of Pokemon, it did a lot of good things right. It had that direct sequel instead of the third game, which tied back to Black and White. I mean, that was really cool. You had the changing battle music. You had the infinite uses of TMs, the animated sprites in battle. You also had a just generally higher difficulty of the game, which was a nice change of pace. And also a more mature story and a new endgame design, which was really quite clever. But overall, I think Generation 5 is just too forgettable at times, which is a shame. It tried to be too philosophical at times with truth and ideals, and while I appreciated that, I think that went over a lot of kids' heads. You had triple battles and rotation battles. That's overkill. That is way too much, and it did not work out at all. You had musicals also, which was probably one of the worst extracurricular activities that you could have put in the Pokemon games. Really, I felt it was just trying to stretch out the end of the DS lifecycle, and you could really feel it reach its limits. Number 3, Generation 2, Gold, Silver, and Crystal. These are the perfect sequels, taking everything that was great about the first one, making it even better, adding new features, and tying back to the first game in a really memorable way. So many great additions to Gold, Silver, and Crystal. You have breeding, shiny Pokemon, female trainer in Crystal. You had the experience progress bar in battle, which was awesome. Pokemon could hold items. You had the steel and dark type to kind of counteract the overpoweredness of psychic in Generation 1. And you had the splitting of the special stat into special attack and special defense. But there are some unfortunate flaws with Generation 2. They added new Pokeballs. They added way too many new Pokeballs. It was also still really held back by the Game Boy technology at the time. I mean, not even Game Boy Advance, but Game Boy. And it also really just lacks the features that later generations would add into the game. Number 2, Generation 3, Ruby, Sapphire, and Emerald, and Fire Red and Leaf Green. Oh man, so many great improvements in Generation 3. First of all, it established how Pokemon are kind of created on a data level with the addition of natures and abilities and a refinement of the IV and EV system. It's what allowed these Generation 3 Pokemon to be brought forth to future iterations of the game. Not only that, but you had distinct story and villain differences between the two games in Ruby and Sapphire. That was a first. You had double battles. You had running shoes. And it was, strange to say, actually the first kind of game platform that allowed users to kind of create their own ROM hacks and create their own custom Pokemon games. Have you ever played Ash Gray? It's pretty awesome. It's a game based on the events of the anime. And then you had Fire Red and Leaf Green, which were the first Pokemon remakes that took a past generation and applied the new generation standards to it. So Fire Red and Leaf Green, the definitive versions of Pokemon Red and Blue. You have to play them. There were definitely some downsides to Generation 3, though. They took all those Pokeballs from Generation 2 and added even more Pokeballs. It just feels so unnecessary for a lot of them. And then you also had the contest mode, which, yeah, it worked out well in the anime, but it was not that fun to play if you asked me in the game. And number 1, Generation 4, Diamond, Pearl, and Platinum, and Heart Gold and Soul Silver. Generation 4 really refined what made the Pokemon series great, and if it had stopped there, personally, I would have been happy with it, because I think that's the best generation. First of all, with the introduction of Wi-Fi on Nintendo DS, it really opened the game up to the world because you had Wi-Fi trading and you had Wi-Fi battling, just people across the world able to communicate with their love of Pokemon. You also had Pokemon moves that changed if they were physical or special based on the move itself and not what type it was. So for example, before Generation 4, let's say you have Thunder Punch and you have Thunderbolt. Both of them used to be special moves because they were electric types, and so they were dependent on the special stat or the special attack stat of the Pokemon. Well, in Generation 4, Thunder Punch became a physical move dependent on attack, and Thunderbolt became a special move because it was dependent on special attack. So that really changed for all the moves, and it was a big game changer. You also had connectivity with games past to import GBA Pokemon into the DS game. You had connections with the Wii. I mean, playing Pokemon Battle Revolution with these games on your DS, it was great. Also, you could record your battles that you played with people online with the Versus Recorder in Platinum. Oh, and don't even get me started on Heart Gold, Soul Silver. Taking one of the best game foundations in Gold and Silver, but it was, you know, flawed by a lot of things in Gen 2, but taking those Gen 3 and Gen 4 refinements over time and making what I think is one of the definitive Pokemon games of all time. Some downsides of Gen 4, I guess, you know, they had Super Contests, which really didn't make contests any better, and Team Galactic was a pretty weak villain, let's just say that for Diamond and Pearl. So I know this is a bit long in the tooth, but I love the Pokemon games, and I hope maybe you agree with me, maybe you disagree with me in this order of what generation is the best, so let me know your order in the comments below, I'd love to hear your opinions. In this piece, listen to when the strings enter to accompany the solo piano. It's one of the more powerful, softer themes that the Pokemon games have ever presented, and it just makes you think of Ferris wheel rides. At number 3, it's Unwavering Emotions. Welcome back. You sent us questions via email, Twitter, and Facebook, so let's answer one. At My Name Is Hat says, how have day one patches and micro DLC changed gaming and how we expect games to release? Why do we put up with mediocre products at launch, and how have companies learned this, causing finished games to not necessarily be a priority? Day one patches, micro DLC, I really don't have a problem with that in particular. When games go into certification, when they go gold, and then eventually end up on store shelves or digital storefronts, it can take a while, so the studios can take that time, whether it's a couple months or what have you, to make further refinements, and I think that's where you see the day one patches. And some micro DLC, it can be good, but of course it's the studios and the publishers more often than not that abuse this system, that force certain dates so that these studios have to rush and that you get lesser products as a result. That, of course, is the problem. Of course, an example of that kind of abuse was what was reported for Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 5, where supposedly the license for Tony Hawk was expiring for Activision, so they were pushing to get it out the door, and so you had a really terrible game at launch that, like, okay, yeah, we could patch it later, and they did, but at what cost? At what hindered the brand and really damaged it going forward? So yeah, I think with micro DLC and day one patches, you know, if they have time to work between when it's certified and then eventually released, yeah, put them to work, absolutely, do that. But when you say, why do we put up with a mediocre product, I think it really depends on what the consumer does with his or her money. Because you can make the biggest impact by choosing not to support a publisher, not support a studio when they're doing practices that you don't like, but some people can't help themselves because they may love the franchise or some other reason. How have companies learned this? Because they still make money regardless of the decisions that they make. If a few people just say, yeah, I won't buy this game, doesn't make that big of an impact. But let's say, for an example, Ubisoft, Assassin's Creed. People got burned so hard with Unity that even though Syndicate was a better game, more people than usual did not buy Assassin's Creed Syndicate. Sales dipped significantly. They spoke with their wallet, and Ubisoft's now noticed and say, hey, no new Assassin's Creed game this year. We're going to take it back and refine it further. That's how you speak with your wallet. Though a recent example of an unfinished game becoming the priority would be Street Fighter V for Capcom, where they want to get the game out in hands of players so that they can practice before EVO 2016, get the game on a national stage. And you don't know if there were external pressures, maybe from Sony as an exclusive partner there, but that's an example of where they say, okay, we can leave out solo modes, we can leave out story mode and have that come in a free update later. It's a bit of a scummy practice, but it's on the player, the consumer, to vote with their wallet and decide what they want to actually purchase and how that affects these game companies when the company's wallet is hurt. Thank you for your question. We would love to receive more, so let us know through Twitter or through email. In this piece, listen to the trumpet's fanfare as it just cuts through that pounding beat. The clash between truth and ideals is about to become legendary. At number two, it's Zekrom and Reshiram battle. Welcome back. When I think of Pokemon Black and White, I think of a generally forgettable Pokemon main series game, but a soundtrack that I loved, and that's why I wanted to talk about it here and kind of reinvigorate the game for myself. And it's a Pokemon game that I want to play when I get back to playing a Pokemon game. Because this was about 5 years ago that this game came out, and I was still working at Toys R Us at the time. I went all in. I got both games. I got the hardcover guide. This was the reboot of Pokemon. I'm like, all right, I am all in. I'm ready for this. There were several things that I really liked, and yeah, we talked about it earlier in the generation discussion, but I really liked how there were only Unova Pokemon before the end of the game, and it really gave that sense of, yeah, it's a reboot. You're only going to experience these new Pokemon in this region, and then you mix in the National Dex Pokemon after that fact, sure, but that was a great little touch, and it kind of reminded you of that whole 151 sort of thing again. The infinite TM uses, amazing. I could just, you know, put Thunderbolt on so many different Pokemon. And I just loved that change in particular. The experience share was a nice upgrade too, and while it didn't become the total possibly game-breaking thing that it was in Generation 6, to have it be based on the difference of levels, based on how the experience was split up, was awesome, especially when you had those rare wild Pokemon patches like you encounter in Audino, and it gave you a huge experience yield and just dropped tons of experience points. And that just really boosted up your lower level Pokemon a lot. It was a tougher game though when I think about it, and I actually had the most difficulty that I ever had with any champion ever with the final boss of the game. Won't spoil that, but the final boss's final Pokemon was this really powerful special sweeper that just felt like it had almost every type covered, and I remember I was stalling with tons of items and just trying to get that one shot in there. I think that's the hardest time I've had with a Pokemon game, and it really gave me that sense of challenge. But yeah, I've always had a soft spot for this soundtrack, especially the changing music in battle, and I don't know why that was not brought back in Generation 6. I hope it is in the upcoming Generation 7 with Sun and Moon. We've already featured on the countdown the gym leader's last stand, victory is right before your eyes. To have that be such a magnificent return of the main Pokemon theme, but also when your health was really low, using that annoying chime that we've heard for years and years into this high frenetic battle pace, it was so, so good, and I hope they really do bring that changing battle music back. At the end of the day, Pokemon Black and White, and especially Black and White 2, they're games I don't remember much of. I don't recall many of the town names or the gym leaders from Unova, and that's something I have to change, so when I play a Pokemon game next, it's gonna be Black and White. When you make a top 10 list for a soundtrack, not everything will make the final cut. That said, here are some songs that we had a hard time leaving on the cutting room floor. Before we get to our number one song, here's a quick recap. Number 10, Castellia City. Number 9, Victory is Right Before Your Eyes. Number 8, Legendary Pokemon Battle. Number 7, Route 10. Number 6, Team Plasma Battle. Number 5, Gym Leader Battle. Number 4, End's Castle. Number 3, Unwavering Emotions. And number 2, Zekrom and Reshiram Battle. In this piece, listen to the high energy throughout in what is usually a calmer and more reflective time. The game may be over, but the player's adventures in Unova are just beginning, whether or not they know it. At number 1, it's Ending to Each Future. And that's the list. Thank you so much for listening, for watching. Really is good to do a Pokemon game because I grew up with the Pokemon games. Blue was my very first game, so maybe we'll have to do those ones in a future episode. But really, to do a Pokemon soundtrack, really love doing that. So if you enjoyed it, like, comment, subscribe, all that good YouTube stuff. We're still working on getting the show up on iTunes and other audio services there. For our YouTube video recommendation this week, you may know of the YouTube channel Gilva Sunner if you are familiar with game music on the internet. But instead of a lowercase L for Gilva Sunner, try a capital I instead. It's a great parody channel, but in particular, I want you to check out the Rhythm Heaven Fever Remix 10 remix from this Gilva Sunner clone. It's a good one. I think you'll like it. Join us next week when we're covering what I believe is the best gaming soundtrack of 2015 and possibly of the last 5 years. Who knows? Undertale! Oh boy, bring it on, internet. To play us out, let's highlight our favorite fan rendition from this game's soundtrack in our remix of the week, and it comes from Glitch X City on YouTube. It's a remix of the Team Plasma Battle theme, and that's a really good one, but I like what Glitch X City did with this one, so I hope you enjoy it. That'll do it for us here. Thank you so much for listening. My name is Peter Spezia, and we'll see you next week on Tempo Control.